and welcome to today's audio conference, Standards for Relationship Testing, Changes from the 11th Edition to the 12th Edition, sponsored by AABB. My name is Lauren Rohde, and I am Program Manager at AABB. In accordance with AABB policy, the instructor and I have signed a conflict of interest form. We have disclosed any significant financial interests or other relationships with industry to the topics that will be discussed during the program. Such disclosures allow you to better evaluate the objectivity of the information presented in the lecture. Please report any undisclosed conflicts of interest that you may perceive on the evaluation form. Following the presentation, all sites will have the opportunity to participate in the question and answer session. Please be sure to write down any questions that you have as we go along. We gladly welcome your input. Presenting today will be Mary Mount. Mary works for the Relationship DNA Testing Services DNA Diagnostic Center at Memorial Blood Centers. I will now turn the floor over to Mary.
Thank you, Lauren, and welcome everyone to the conference, audio conference today. The first slide is our introduction. It says AABB Standards for Relationship Testing Laboratories 12th Edition Preview. So that's what we're going to be discussing today. This slide is a list of all the people that have participated in creating these standards, and I want to thank them personally for all they've done. It was a long couple of years getting this all together, so thanks again to the members of the committee. So I wanted to also bring you up to date on the features of the 12th edition of the standards. There will be a standards portal available. That will be available for purchase through the AABB, and you'll be able to log on at aabb.org. The standards will have guidance available right next to the standard to view. If additional guidance is needed somewhere during the two-year cycle, the Standards Relationship Testing and Standards Program Unit will be able to create the guidance, and it will be uploaded quickly to the site. The appendix is also available on that site. And if you have questions about the portal, please go to contact standards at aabb.org for questions or more information about the standards portal. All facilities will receive a printed copy of the standards and of the guidance document. So we'll get started with the changes from the 11th to the 12th edition. So we wrote a new standard, 1.1.7, so that is in the, that one, pertains to laboratory directors, director designees, and supervisors, that we will ask for official transcripts from those folks. We added this to provide additional documentation attesting to everyone's qualification. And we also added guidance for this particular new standard. The next change was to 2.1.1. Personnel shall be qualified to perform assigned activities on the basis of appropriate education, training, and/or experience. The committee elected to remove the clause restricting the standard to performing critical tasks, believing that it should have a broader application. The next change was to 3.2, which is in the equipment section. Equipment shall be qualified for its intended use. And we added the phrase, equipment repairs and upgrades shall be evaluated and equipment requalified based on the facility's policies and manufacturer's recommendations. We expanded this standard and added additional guidance for this standard. Added a new standard to 4.7, which is 4.7.1. This is the facility shall have policies, processes, and procedures to evaluate and respond to possibly altered or fabricated documents. The committee added the standard to ensure that all documents that appear to have been altered and that the laboratory deems critical to its function are evaluated. We were concerned about, I think a lot of the laboratories have received copies of fabricated documents, especially test reports, and we wanted to make sure we had some standard in here that would apply to that and investigate how that happened, if possible. The next change was to 5.1.3.2. Quality control results shall be reviewed and evaluated against acceptance criteria. Quality control failures shall be investigated. Chapter 9, Process Improvement Through Corrective and Preventative Action, applies. The committee removed the clause before release of test results, products, or services at the end of the last sentence after investigation and this was for clarity. Oftentimes, all of the investigation cannot be completed before test results have to be released, but at least most of that can be done. So we wanted to make sure that we also put Chapter 9, the Process Improvement Through Corrective and Preventative Action, in the standard, that particular process improvement applies to this particular standard. There was also a change to 5.2, sample collection for chain of custody cases. The committee added the phrase for chain of custody cases and removed just of sample collection after verification in the description of the standard itself. There's also a change to 5.2.3, which is verification of sample collection, and we added and documentation to emphasize the need for documentation, even though the standard requires record retention. We just want to make sure that everybody documents the sample receipt and all the things that apply to sample collection. We also made a change to 5.2.3.5, samples intended for immigration. We added the visa and passport at the request of the State Department. The addition, along with immigration and citizenship testing, matches what is required by individuals attempting to validate citizenship. So that was at the request of the U.S. Department of State. The next change, we made a new standard, 5.2.3.6. The laboratory shall have policies, processes, and procedures to identify non-chain of custody cases. In place of having standards for non-chain cases, the committee added a standard to require accredited labs to have policies, processes, and procedures to identify and handle non-chain of custody cases. Under 5.2.4, identification records, we made a change to 5.4.2.3. We added the phrase and type for place, date, and type of sample collected for clarity and completeness. Under 5.2.4, again, the change to 5.4.2.6, a history of transfusion in the preceding 3 months for any history of allogeneic hematopoietic progenitor cell transplantation. We removed if a blood sample is collected, which was deemed to be inaccurate as it pertains to the whole body of the 12th edition. The next change was to, again, 5.2.4 under 5.2.4.8. The name of the person receiving the sample in the laboratory, data of receipt, and documentation of shipment receipt. So we want to make sure that the shipment receipt documents is documented for completeness. There was a change to 5.3.7.1. With relationship testing other than parentage, we removed the words non-parentage and replaced it with other than parentage. The replacement does not alter the intent of the standard itself. There was also a change to 5.3.11.2. We changed some wording in this. The committee removed consistency and replaced it with accuracy and reproducibility to be more accurately reflect the language used in the field today. And we also removed the words precision and accuracy in parentheses in the 11th that were found in the 11th edition. The same thing is for 5.3.11.3. We did this exact same thing to mirror the 5.3.11.2. So the same changes were made to 5.3.11.3. There was also a change made to 6.1.2, use of standardized formats for all policies, processes, and procedures. Additional procedures such as those in manufacturer's instructions or package inserts may be incorporated by reference. We added this phrase, by reference, and shall be incorporated into the master list of documents. The committee added this to ensure that package inserts or manufacturer's instructions were not used as the standard operating procedure, but could appear as supporting documentation. There was also a change made to 6.1.5. Use of current invalid documents. Applicable documents shall be available at all locations. And then we added the phrase, out-of-date documents shall be removed from workstations when updated ones are replaced in service. This may seem redundant, but our lead assessor stated that she often cites this because for some reason or other, out-of-date documents are found in the laboratory from time to time in her inspection assessments. 6.2.1.1, we added and indelible just for completeness to that standard. The next change was to 6.3.3. The laboratory should have a process to ensure that relationship testing services and test reports meet these RT standards before distribution or delivery. And we added the reference standard 6.3A requirements for test report supply, just for completeness to that particular standard. The next change was to 6.4.4. The laboratory shall participate in data collection and submission for AABB relationship testing annual report through the provision of requested data. We added a pen symbol to this to make sure that laboratories maintain records or documentation to show that they have submitted the data to AABB for the annual report. 6.3AB1. Report the phenotypes of tested individuals for all genetic systems. We added the phrase, with the exception of amylogen and other markers used for gender determination and linked loci as defined in standard 5.5 for completeness. This committee is working on the guidance for standard 5.5 right now. So that will be updated probably after our conference call in December. So please stay tuned for that. There was a change made to 6.3AB3. If there is a failure to exclude and results are unusual and conclusive or involve relationship testing other than parentage and do not meet the standard 5.3.7.1. We added or involve relationship testing other than parentage for completeness of that particular standard. There was a change to 7.1. Upon discovery, the root causes of non-conforming materials, samples, and services shall be investigated, and the disposition of these non-conforming materials, samples, and services shall be determined. We added this for clarity and completeness to this particular standard. The next standard change was to 8.1.4, the results of internal and external assessments and the associated corrective and preventative action shall be reviewed by relevant testing personnel and executive management. We felt that the relevant testing personnel should also be reviewing this, especially if they've been involved in the reason for the nonconformance. The next standard, standard 8.2 was added. It was actually moved from 9.2 to 8.2. The committee monitoring the flow better and actually this was quality monitoring flowed better in Chapter 8, assessments in internal and external, than in Chapter 9. I just would like to thank the staff at AABB National Office who were outstanding. We could not have done our job without Christopher Boquette, Eduardo Nunez, Carolyn Maddy, Nikki Bass Jeffrey, and Marcia Dietz, our T Lead assessor. Now I'd like to open the floor for any questions or comments.
This is Sorensen Genomics. We have a question about the change to 7.1. Are you stating that you must have more than one root cause for each nonconformance?
Let me get to that. Oh, no, not that there should be more than one. It was kind of a general statement that upon discovery, any root causes of nonconforming material samples or services shall be investigated and their disposition determined. So if there's only one root cause, you're going to be determining that and documenting that.
Okay, it's just a little confusing. ISO standards are going to be changing, and they may require more than one root cause, so I thought that's why you were going that way.
We just wanted to clarify. Before, it didn't even have the root causes of nonconformance, the root causes of in that particular framework. So we just wanted to make sure that any or all, probably is what we probably should have said, but even if you only have one root cause for the particular thing, it may be that the balance was out of order. I don't really know, and so the root cause would be that it needed to be recalibrated or, some such thing. So it's not necessarily multiple ones. Depends on what you're... Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, I have another question. This is Sorensen Genomics again.
Okay.
Under standard 1.1.7, you say that you must receive official transcripts. What is your definition of official? Does that mean that it must have a signature and a seal, or does it have to be sent directly to the laboratory and not be in the hands of the employee prior to?
That's a good question, because I think what our intent was that as long as we could have the person present their official transcript or have them contact their college or university and have that sent directly to the laboratory, as long as you have some official documentation of their qualifications.
Okay, because we request transcripts that have a signature and a seal, but quite often it says not official. And so I want to make sure that we're still in compliance, even though it's been given by the university. It just says not official because it was handed to the student themselves.
And in this particular case, I think as long it will, so it says on the transcript, not official?
Yes.
Okay. So you weren't, so the person called their university and the university sent it to the student, not to you?
Yes. Correct. Okay. But it still has the seal and a signature. We do not accept transcripts that you can just print out from, because it looks like a Word document.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm sure that if Marcia has approved it before, or that she will do that again. I think that as long as it's got a seal and a signature on it, it should be just fine.
Great. Okay, I have one last question. I feel like
okay.
I'm...
No, that's fine.
Taking over thing. On the changes, the new standard for 4.7.1 that for fabricated documents, and
right.
The guidance says the laboratory deems critical to the function. So how is an altered report critical to the laboratory's function?
Well, if it's like a test report that's been issued and they've altered that test report, that would be critical to the function of the laboratory in that there's a report out there that isn't accurate. Does that make sense?
Yes, and then what is the laboratory supposed to do? We don't have any authority to contact the police or anyone.
Well, I think, you know, as long as you can investigate it and show that you've done, you know, everything you can to, if you were doing it for court and they presented to the court a fabricated document and you had, and the court came back and said, is this really an accurate document? Or they had two different documents, which one is right? At least you'd be investigating it and you could actually send the correct copy to the court, for instance.
Okay. All right.
You know?
All right. Thank you very much.
Yeah. You're welcome.
The American Red Cross Laboratory in Portland.
Hi.
Actually, two questions. So one is another question regarding 1.1.7. I understand the need for transcripts in the event folks don't have a background in science, but if you have a master's or PhD in a scientific background, do you still need to have transcripts on file?
We did discuss this, and even though somebody might, you might know them because they worked in another laboratory or something, you should probably have, what we said was you should have copies of their transcripts as well.
As well as a copy of their degree.
The diploma.
Yes.
Okay. And then my second question is regarding the history of transfusion, and it's just a general question. So, and it's 5.4.2.6, we were just wondering if you happen to have any data that you might be willing to share, just so that we have it for our own information on, essentially the contamination or the interference with the buccal swab collection from a transfusion. Is there any data?
I think there's some articles out there, and I will investigate that. And maybe I can get your phone number or some sort of a, could I send this to your medical director or your laboratory director?
Yep.
You're in Portland, right? Red Cross?
Yep.
Okay.
Thank you.
There are, I believe, articles out there that have shown that some buccal swabs in particular cases of transplantation and things like that, there have been some changes in the buccal swabs as well. So I'll make sure we get something to your laboratory director.
Thank you so much.
Okay, you're welcome.
Hi, Mary. This is Shelley from PTC, and thank you so much for doing this today.
You're welcome. Thank you.
I have a question about the addition to standard 5.2.4. And this is about, in addition to documenting, you know, who received the sample at the laboratory, when we received it, what's been added is documentation of the shipment receipt. What is exactly intended by that?
Just like the date the sample was the shipment was received from, so that there is actually a kind of a chain of custody all the way through, to have the date of the shipment arriving at the laboratory. Most people keep track of that somehow or other, but not necessarily. It may not be maintained.
It was part of the standard previously, wasn't it? What I'm trying to figure out is if documentation means, you know, what carrier, what tracking number, what copy of air bill, or if it really does just mean date of receipt.
I think mostly we're, you know, it is whatever I think you determine as a laboratory director, what you define as the requirements. So if it's the date of the receipt, if you want to keep a copy of the FedEx or DHL or UPS or, you know, tracking number or however you want to do it, we just want to make sure that you have something down there, at least the date that the sample was received.
Okay.
And keep that with the records.
Right, and I was just trying to understand what the intent of the change was.
I think there were a lot of people that don't keep track of the sample receipt, and then you know, if there's ever a question in the future about when the sample was received or by whom, like the person that actually received it in the laboratory, some of those things, then they're, you know, especially in court, then at least you'd have the documentation there if you needed to go to court with anything.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hello, this is Manjula here.
Hi.
Thank you for the informative talk. And I agree with the transfusion reference. Is it possible for you to send us also the transfusion reference for buccal swab?
Sure. And what company are you with?
I am the Center for Medical Genetics, Houston, Texas.
Oh, in Houston.
Yeah. And regarding, I have one question regarding the change to 8.1.4 regarding internal and external assessments and review procedure.
Okay.
You mentioned that it has to be done by all the testing personnel and the management. So do you want us to keep the documentation for that with the signature that they have reviewed it and put it in the folders, inspection folder?
Yeah, the intent is for anybody that actually participated in the internal and external assessment.
Okay.
If there was anything that has a corrective or preventative action, that the personnel that were involved with that there should be documentation and review by that person. And so, yeah, if they could sign and date it or initial that they reviewed it or however you want to, you decide you want to keep that documentation, but that was the intent. Not only should executive management look at it, but the people that actually were participating in the internal or external assessment.
So is it like only for the corrective action, or it is general inspection for the whole, like, for example, checklist procedure? When the person, like, there are two kinds of review they do, testing personnel as well. One is the checklist preparation, review of checklist preparation, and the second is any kind of like non-conformance is there, review of that and take the corrective action. So,
well, this would be internal or external assessments.
Okay.
So okay. Not, you know, I think you probably keep track of whenever there is a, you know, if there's an error made in corrective action and all that, that's appropriate. But this is just, this one pertains only to internal and external assessments.
Okay.
All right.
Okay,
that help?
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi, Mary. This is Independent Forensics in Illinois. I just wanted to clarify the language and the intent of just a couple of the changes that you highlighted.
Okay.
Going back to 4.7.1, referring to the possible altered or fabricated documents, we discussed it a little bit with reference to test reports that we have issued. Is that the only intent of the rule, or is it also intended to refer to evaluating and responding possible altered or fabricated documents that are presented to us, like identification documents or, immigration documents or anything like that, documents that we receive as opposed to documents that we issue?
That's a very good question. Well, I think one thing that you have to, anything that is deemed critical to your function. So if there's a possibility to investigate some of these other things other than just the reports, I think, sometimes you wonder about if you know that something has been fabricated, then you should be investigating it. That's kind of what my take is on this particular document. So if you have an identification document of some sort or other that you know is altered, because sometimes you don't even know that documents are fabricated or altered until somebody from the State Department, for instance, in an immigration case tells you it is, but things that you deemed that you know that are possibly altered or fabricated, that should be things you investigate.
Sure. I just, because it calls for policies, processes, and procedures, I want to make sure that whatever I write addresses all of the necessary subject matters. You know what I'm trying to get
well,
at?
I think you can just, have a general, make it in your policies, processes, and procedures, make it a kind of a general that to investigate altered documents, and then you can put examples down. But, I don't know that you can even think of everything that possibly could be altered.
Sure. Okay. Okay, and then let's see here. Under 5.2.3.6, laboratories shall have policies, processes, and procedures. Now, in the left-hand column where the specific change to the standard is written, it says to identify non-chain of custody cases. In the guidance, it uses very similar language, but it says identify and handle non-chain of custody cases. So it's another one of these, do I simply have to identify which of our cases are chain of custody versus non-chain of custody, or do I also, within those policies, processes, and procedures, have to, sort of spell out how they are to be handled separately, from any procedures that we have for our chain of custody cases?
I think the intent is to have it identified that they are, that the differences between chain cases and non-chain cases.
Mm-hmm.
And that, how you handle them. You've already got documentation on the chain cases, but the actual guidance is not a standard, so you're going to determine how you identify the non-chain from the chain.
Okay,
so
yeah, I just want to make sure what my documentation had to cover, strictly the identification of them as opposed to all of the ancillary, steps that go into what would be described as sort of handling them. Okay, and then my last one is a really simple one. Directly underneath that, it talks about 5.2.4, the place, date, and type of sample collected. Is that simply referring to, you know, buccal swab versus blood collection versus amniocentesis, et cetera, or is there another meaning to type of sample that I am?
No, that you've got it right. That's exactly what we meant.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
And again, if you have any questions, okay, it looks like we have no further questions at this time. So we'll go ahead and conclude the question and answer session. And we would like to remind you that AABB has a facility audio conference scheduled for tomorrow, for Wednesday, November 18th. And this audio conference is titled, Using Competency Assessments to Assure Quality. State coordinators should visit the AABB website for more details. After the audio conference, host site coordinators will be emailed instructions on how to access audio conference evaluations and how to receive a CE certificate for the session. This process is different than from previous years, so please keep an eye out from AABB within 24 hours with full instructions. Thanks again to all of our sites for participating in this valuable program, and thank you, Mary, for giving such a great presentation. If you have any questions that were not answered today, please send them directly to the AABB Professional Development Department at professionaldevelopment@aabb.org. This concludes today's audio conference. Thank you.